set.
I think so.
Like to call the January 11th school committee meeting to order. This tonight predominantly will be the start of the budget season, and we'll have the this overview by the superintendent. And then on Thursday night, we'll start to dig into the different cost centers.
We'll be digging in tonight, too.
I mean, after we have our budget books. Before we do that, I'd like to open the meeting to any public input that's not related to the budget. And for... Yeah.
Do they?
No, that's budget. And seeing none is, we can do reports. Alex, did you have one?
So winter break was last week, so we just got back. Midterms are also next week, unless you're junior, which is awesome. And on Monday is the Martin Luther King Day celebration. And the choruses at the high school will be singing. That's it.
Thank you.
I don't have anything tonight, no.
Jean?
No.
Yes.
I just wanted to add on that also at the Martin Luther King Day celebration, the GSA will have representatives there, as well as the World of Difference program. And when you see these around town, let them be a reminder to please join us on Monday, Martin Luther King Day. Thank you.
I'm all set.
Nothing for me.
John, did you?
I do not have anything.
Okay. We have a consent agenda. Is there anything that anyone would like taken off the consent agenda? No?
Mr. Chair, move to approve the consent agenda as presented.
Is there a second?
I second that.
All those in favor? 5-0. Okay, we're ready for the budget.
Can I just make a comment about
Sure.
something that you just approved on the consent agenda, which had
Yes.
nothing to do with your vote, but I just wanted to inform. So as you saw, one of the donations that you approved was for $500 for Narcan doses for the 8 schools. So recently, and a lot of school districts are now doing this, recently all of our nurses got trained in administering Narcan, which is a drug that's used to offset the effects of an opioid overdose. So we now will have in all of our 8 schools Narcan available in case we have a situation where we may need to use it. But we do have now all trained nurses in our buildings. The donation purchases one dose of Narcan for each of the 8 schools. So I want to thank the Rotary Club for that, and also to announce that we now have the ability to use it in our 8 schools.
Thank you.
Okay.
Ready for the budget?
Yes. So what you have in front of you in the handout is the beginnings of the presentations, and we're going to have several presentations over the next few weeks regarding the superintendent's recommended budget. I do want to add as a caveat to this year's presentations that I would like to use the word recommended a little bit looser this year, because obviously the budget that I'm presenting you to this year wouldn't really necessarily be my recommended budget. Mm-hmm. In a perfect world, it would be more of a level service budget that I'd be presenting you tonight. But as we know, with the restrictions on finances that we have in our community, you're not getting what would be a true recommended budget. So what I want to do tonight, because this presentation is for the school committee, it's also for the community, and we're going to be broadcast on RCTV, is I want to have a beginning conversation about how the budget process works, so that everyone understands the context. We've had lots of presentations with parents and community, and I've always received a lot of questions about, so how does a budget go from the beginning to the end of the process and it gets approved? So I want to talk a little bit about that first, and then we can get into the context of the actual budget. So the budget process for the next fiscal year actually starts in September and October, when the town manager and I and other department heads and town officials, we start having conversations about the revenues that are projected for the following year and for the expenses that we're anticipating. Most of the time, the conversation we have is about accommodated costs, which I'm going to talk a little bit about. There is a financial forum, as we all know, where the school committee, the finance committee, the board of selectmen, and the library board of trustees meet. And at those meetings, we're having conversations about those projected financial numbers. From there, a budget plan is developed. The number is developed based on the accommodated costs, based on what we think are going to be the expenses. I think what's important is that for the last 2 years, we've walked into the budget process with a lot more budget certainty because some agreements have been made up front in terms of we've come up with certain estimations, and if they go above or be below those estimations, then those would be dealt with outside of the budget process. So I think it's important that the last 2 years, it's been much more budget certainty. For those of you who've been on the committee know that some years we were waiting for health insurance numbers to come in. Other years we were waiting for state aid numbers to come in or both. We know what our number is, and barring any major influx and change, the number isn't going to really change. From October to December, we then start developing our budget. We're meeting with principals, we're meeting with directors, central office administrators. As you know, last May and June, I met with the community to have conversations with them, which then continued in this fall. And so we received a lot of input in the development of this budget. And it also set the foundation for future discussions on future budgets. Tonight, I'm going to be presenting to you the beginnings of the recommended budget. You will be spending time over the next few weeks hearing about the cost centers, hearing about the budget numbers. There is a public hearing that will be later on this month. And then at the end of the month, you'll be taking a vote as a school committee. That then becomes the school committee budget. That budget then gets turned over to the town manager. The town manager then develops a budget, which by statute, by charter, matches what fiscally is responsible for the town. That budget goes to the finance committee. The finance committee is the advisory committee to town meeting. We will be spending a meeting with the finance committee, reviewing the school committee budget with them. And then the finance committee will be taking a series of votes, not just on the school committee budget, but all of the town budgets, and be giving recommendations in April or May at town meeting on the budget. So we're right at the beginning of this process right now, but really that's how it works. Town meeting has the final say on the budget, but there's a lot of steps before that. Here are all of the dates of the upcoming meetings. So tonight we're going to be doing an overview of the budget and the administration in the regular day cost centers. On Thursday evening, Carolyn will be doing a special education budget presentation for you. We'll also be doing the district-wide services. January 20th, the financial forum is a very important meeting. There'll be a lot of discussion about both the FY17 budget and I think a few future budget discussions. There'll be a public hearing on the 21st. By law, we have to have a public hearing on the budget, although every school committee meeting, you could say, is a public hearing where the public has the opportunity to give input. We'll also be hearing from Joe Huggins, where he will be presenting on the town and school facilities budget, which, as you know, this year is a separate budget, and it's an independent budget area. And then on Monday, we'll be starting to answer the questions that you've come up with. Potentially, you could be taking a vote on the 25th. If not, a vote on the 28th, if necessary, that night is available. And then the budget is submitted to the town manager by charter by February 1st. And then on the 16th of March is when we have the finance committee meeting to present the budget to them.
Can I interrupt just for a second, Mr. Chairman? Can I just call the finance committee?
Oh,
we have a quorum. Thank you. Sorry.
So that's the upcoming dates for the
I just, on that schedule, I just wanted to highlight that on the 12th tomorrow, and then the 19th,
Thank you.
The Board of Selectmen meet and are discussing their budget, and I believe tomorrow night will be also the facilities, the town-wide facilities and school facilities. So while we're going over the schedule and advertising this to the community, those are two important meetings that the Board of Selectmen are having on budget.
Correct.
Tuesday the 12th and Thursday the 19th. I mean, Tuesday the 19th.
You also reminded me that I'm going to be giving two presentations Tuesday and Wednesday night to the school community. The PTOs had asked that I present the budget as well, so I will be presenting the budget tomorrow night at 6:30 at Coolidge, and then Wednesday night at 6:30 at Parker. So setting the context, and I think it's important that, as we discussed at the last school committee meeting, that it really is the district action plan, the goals of the school district, that help drive the direction that we're going as with the budget. And we develop our budget based on the five goals of the school district. So here are our five district goals. We're in the second year of most of these goals. Certainly the first three goals are the three that focus on student learning and teaching and learning and building our capacity of our staff so that they can effectively work with students. Goal four focuses on the resources needed to do that, and goal five is the improvement of communication with both internally and externally. But when we are developing our budget, these are the five goals that drive the direction that we're going. Here are our five goals. At the top and underneath are all of the different initiatives that we are working on currently. Throughout the presentations, I will highlight for you the areas that are connected to these five goals so that you can see the connection between the budget and our district action plan. One of the things that we look at when we're developing our budget is enrollment. And I would say we're very fortunate here in Reading that our enrollment has stayed relatively steady over the last several years. We do see some fluctuation between levels when we have a population bubble coming through. But for the most part, as you could see, the green represents the high school, the red represents the middle school, the blue is the elementary school, that there's been very little movement of students in terms of numbers of students over the last several years. And what we're seeing right now in 15-16 is that we did see a decrease in enrollment at the middle school this year and an increase in enrollment at the elementary and high school. We also want to take a look at our special education. The original chart that I sent you was incorrect. The one that you received this afternoon is correct. But you can see that here that we've also seen, we stay around the state average in our special education enrollment. This year from 14-15 to 15-16, our current year, we did see a decrease in the number of students that are on IEPs, so we're at about 18%, which is a little bit higher than the state average. You also see that over the last several years, we range between 50 and 73 students that are out of district at any one time. We've been the last 2 years in the 60s. So our numbers stay really similar to the state average in special education. One of the areas that we have seen some increases in is the other high needs areas, most particularly our limited English proficient students. And you remember earlier in the school year, I asked that we had to hire an additional English language learner teacher because you could see from 14-15 to 15-16, we've seen a spike of increase of 20 students with limited English proficient, which they require services, and we were actually not able to deliver those services effectively to all of the limited English proficient and first language, not English students in the school district. So we had to increase staffing, and we're up to now 2.5 English language learner teachers. This is actually a trend that a lot of districts are seeing, that there has been an increase in students with limited English proficiency. We also saw, not this year, but last year, we did see an increase in students that are economically disadvantaged students. This year, that number went down a little bit, but that number did go up last year when we were making this presentation. Our class sizes, for the most part, have also remained fairly steady. As you know, we do have the guidelines of the school committee that in grades K to 2, we make every effort to maintain the class sizes between 18 to 22. Grades 3, 4, and 5, we try to keep them in the mid-20s. And at the middle school, usually they are also in the mid-20s. The high school is a little bit different to measure class size because of the different offerings, electives, course sections that we have at the high school. But you can see for the major core subjects in grades 9, 10, 11, and 12, the class sizes are in the low 20s. Grades 6, 7, and 8, you sometimes see higher class sizes at the middle school because of the team structure, the team model. And because students are with a group of teachers on an interdisciplinary team, you can't, like at elementary or at high school, just add a teacher to a department or to a grade level, which would lower the class sizes. At middle school, because it's an interdisciplinary model, you would need either a half a team or a whole team, which would be either two teachers or four teachers, and you would need the classroom space to be able to do that to get some of those class sizes down. But the way the model is set up, it does support slightly higher class sizes. So that's why sometimes you do see some higher class sizes at the middle school. So a little bit about the how we get to the budget number. Again, this is more of a context for the community. So as most of us know, that our revenue sources, the majority of our revenue sources are property taxes here in the community. There is also other local revenue sources, such as excise tax or meals tax, things like that. State aid makes a big, also makes a big part of our the revenue sources. The majority of that is Chapter 70 funding. I do want to talk briefly about Chapter 70 funding. And so I did talk a little bit about this at previous school committee meetings. So Chapter 70 is the amount of funding that the state provides for education. It's based on a formula that was developed when ed reform was passed in 1993. So if you could think about what has changed in education since 1993 and the costs associated with education since 1993, which include things such as health costs, special education costs, technology, which didn't really exist too much in 1993, and some other areas, the greater needs for English language learning students, full-day kindergarten, all of those things, the formula is outdated. So the legislature 2 years ago formed a foundation budget commission to take a look at the formula to see what changes could be made or what changes could be recommended. And on October 30th, the Budget Commission released their final report. And to no surprise to anyone, the foundation budget formula is outdated. That's the easy part of the problem. The more difficult the problem is, well, how do you fix it? To fix it, really, you need to do two things. One is you need to fix the formula to look so that it takes a look at things like healthcare cost increases and special education cost increases and other things, but you also have to increase the pie, the amount that the state gives. And without those two things happening, districts are not going to see a major increase in Chapter 70 funding. The other problem is, where is that funding going to come from? And as we know right now, the governor just made some mid-year cuts. They're talking about next year potentially up to $1 billion deficit in the state budget if changes aren't made. So I'm not sure if we're going to see any relief from Chapter 70 in the very near future. If we do see relief in the near future, it's going to probably be done over several years, like it was done the last time they increased Chapter 70. So I want to add that piece about Chapter 70. You could see also, and the town manager has talked about this several times, is more and more the budget is relying on free cash. And although the town does have cash reserves, and those cash reserves over the last few years have regenerated for due to some one-time things that have happened. As we all know, it isn't a healthy practice to use as much free cash as we're using. A few years ago, we had probably $500,000 we were using free cash, maybe even less, and now we're up to $2 million. So this budget is relying on an influx of free cash each year, which, as we know, is not a good situation. So,
John, is the FY15, is that the net amount we used, or is that the amount that the FinCom authorized to use? The $1.7 million.
I think that's what was authorized.
That seems high to me. We didn't ultimately use that, correct?
I think you're correct. I think that's what we authorized.
That's what was authorized.
For the budget process, that's what you authorized for FinCom. And that was not all used, but during the year, we did use more free cash for things like capital, maybe snow and ice, I don't remember. So it wouldn't surprise me if the use of free cash was at least $2 million.
Okay. Thank you.
So the total pool of funds available is $90 million. And so then from there, we take a look at the accommodated costs. These are the discussions, as you know, we have in October. These are the projected accommodated costs for FY17. And I won't go into detail. The town manager does a much better job of this than I do. But you could see things like benefits and debt are... and part of that debt is due to the library project. Those are your big drivers. So the budget that's developed, the accommodated costs come out first from that $90 million pool, and then what is left is then split between the town and the schools. And as you know from the last... I'm looking at the chart, but the chart looks off. That doesn't look like the right chart. I forgot to put the new chart in.
Sorry.
Because facilities was moved into the core facilities budget now, the split is a little bit different. The split is now approximately 64-36%. In the past, it was 66. It was different. It was a different split. So...
John.
That's why you may see the numbers a little bit different in the book, and I know that was one of the questions.
And just to add some further clarification to that, that the justification for that is the facilities budget is predominantly schools. So I just want to clarify, it's not that the money is now not being spent on schools, it's just in a different place, correct?
That is correct.
Okay, thank you.
So as we were developing the FY17 budget, the number that was agreed upon in October was the $40,697,667, which is a 3.25% increase. There's the FY16 adopted budget, which was $39,473,353. What I am recommending in the FY17 budget is a number that is slightly higher, $150,000 higher, and the purpose of that increase is to fund the first year of the science curriculum, of a three-year science curriculum implementation. When we get into the regular day budget, we can talk a little bit more about that. But the feeling is where these are more one-time costs and not ongoing costs, and we're looking at a three-year implementation of science. The frameworks are getting approved for science by the state in this month, and science implementation has been long overdue. We have not had a major overhaul in our science curriculum for probably about 25 years, that we felt that this was an additional amount that we could ask for. So that brings it up to a 3.5.
I guess we'll talk more tonight about that or a different night?
Tonight. A 3.5% increase. Now, what I do want to compare it to is what a level service budget would have been. And a level service budget would have actually been about a 4.6% increase. So to put it into context, a level service budget, essentially, you're taking the services that you're doing this year and you're moving them forward a year with all of the contractual increases and other known increases that you would have with the implementation of those services. So if we were going to do a true level service budget with the current services that we have, it would actually be closer to a $41 million budget, or a 4.6% increase. And over the last 3 years, we've had to reduce our level service budget each year by an amount of money from that level service budget. So in FY15, which was last year's budget, we reduced our level service budget by $285,000. In FY16, the current fiscal year, remember we made close to $850,000 in cuts. And in this year's budget, the number that is being reduced from the level service budget is $658,193. So the reductions that we are making that you will see this evening is for that amount, $658,193. The percent budget increase over the last several fiscal years is on this slide here. The average five-year increase has been 2.64%. You can see that in FY 10, 11, and 12, that's when we had the economic crisis going on throughout the country. Those numbers weren't very favorable. We have seen some better increases in 13, 14, 15, and then 16, we were at 2.75 last year. but the average five-year increase is 2.64%. By cost center, over the last five fiscal years, you can see that for the most part, they've been in the twos, and we did school facilities has decreased over time, and a lot of that's been due to the utility costs and the efficiencies that we've done over time in the facilities budget. So you could, and that's how you get to the 2.64%. You've seen this chart before, but it really shows the per pupil expenditure since FY06. And you could see that in FY06, the difference between the Reading's per pupil expenditure and the state average was a lot narrower, that gap. But as you go over time, what has happened is the state per pupil expenditure, the average has gone up higher than Reading's. And so the gap is now much wider in FY14 than it was in FY06. And just so you know, FY14 is the last numbers we have right now at the state level. They have not released the FY15 numbers yet. So that's why we can only show you up to FY14. So along with this, a similar graph, it shows the ranking of our per pupil expenditure over the last several fiscal years. And so you could see that we did peak at 232 out of 325 communities in FY06. And since then, there has been a noticeable decrease. We're now, we're at about 305 out of 325 in FY14. I think the important point to make here that is critical is that we know of a lot of school districts that have a very high per pupil and don't get the results that Reading does. And that's not, I don't think that's what I'm presenting here. What I think is important is the lack of sustainability we have in our resources. If we could stay in a similar area and stay comparable to other school districts and increase at the same rate of other school districts, that would keep us competitive with other school districts. But what is happening, as we continue to lose ground in this ranking and as the gap gets wider between us and the state average and our comparable communities, we're having difficulty competing with other school districts and staying on par with them. And you know, one of the things that we looked at is, and I know I got a lot of questions about this chart, so I apologize, but what I did is I took a look at in FY14 who was at these rankings and what was their per pupil. And then multiplied it by our enrollment in FY14. And so, using 232, for example, if we were ranked 232 today, and I can't remember what community it was, that the budget that would be, the amount of revenue, additional revenue that would be available would be about $5.8 million. And that would be town and schools. It wouldn't just be schools. But I think it shows the amount that we have decreased over the last several years. Each of these represents the ranking down below, and I apologize if you can't see it. But it's when you say, you know, wow, what could you do with $5 million? Well, yeah, I think, you know, we're showing, seeing tonight that it would allow us to keep our level service budget. So I think it's important to understand that it's not the amount that matters, it's the fact that we haven't been able to stay sustainable.
John, I'm sorry, I'm still a little confused by that previous chart.
Okay.
Can you explain again, the bottom numbers are the, I apologize.
Those rankings.
Okay, got it.
Okay, so I just did them in the same order. And
so it's chronological.
Yep.
It is good, I'm right to be reading it chronological.
Yep.
Thank you, thanks, that helps.
So you understand how I got the numbers?
I do,
okay.
Thank you.
We also have a group of comparable communities, which we've used for the last few years. These comparable communities are based on a variety of factors, which include, I believe, property values, demographics,
form of government.
I think the town does use similar comparable communities, not all the same, but similar. And you can see we do have, with our comparable communities, we are lower than the rest of the communities. And this is, again, FY14 numbers.
But not significant.
Mm.
One of the other things we want to look at is, okay, so how do we compare in the different expenditure areas? Are we spending more or less in some areas compared to the state average? You can see, for the most part, we are below the state average in spending in all of these areas. The only one that we're $38 above is professional development. And you could see that. And again, that's, you know, investing in our teaching staff.
But that's all, we have tuition reimbursement.
And tuition reimbursement is part of that as well, right? Professional development isn't just providing workshops for teachers. There's a whole bunch of things that go into professional development under the state guidelines. When we take a look at spending, per pupil spending with our comparable communities in the ranking, the total in-district spending rating is 9th out of 13. Administration is 8th out of 13. Classroom and specialist teachers, 11th. Instruction materials is 2nd, and professional development is 2nd among the comparable communities. The classroom specialists and teachers, that there's a couple reasons for this. One is that the salaries of teachers are lower than the state average. We also, though, have a younger, less veteran staff. I believe 40% of our staff have less than 10 years experience. So that does contribute to that number a little bit. Special education spending is certainly another piece of data we want to look at as we're developing the budget. And you can see here that we have our in-district instruction, which includes all of our program teachers, learning center teachers, paraeducators, materials and supplies related to a student's IEP, specialized equipment. And then you have your out-of-district tuitions that we spend. And you could see over the last few years, the last few fiscal years that are recorded here, that these numbers are going down and these numbers are going up. And that's really what you want to see, is that the student, we're more and more of our students are staying in district, and less are going out of district, which means that we're trying to strengthen our programs to keep our students with their peers in district situations. You could see also, compared to the state average, that the percent of the school operating budget, it is slightly higher than the state average percentage for special education spending. Mm-hmm. Again, when you look at comparable communities, in FY10, we actually were the 4th highest district in spending. That's because we had more students in out-of-district placements, or we had them in more expensive out-of-district placements, such as private instead of the collaboratives. But as you can see over time, what has happened, again, because our programs have gotten stronger, is that we're now ranked lower out of the 13 communities in special education spending. One of the other things I think it's important is that the budget that has always been approved at town meeting, we've done an excellent job of managing our funds, and in a lot of cases we've actually turned back funds where we had them available. You can see in the last two fiscal years we have turned back some funds back at the end of the year. Most of those funds have been in special education, out of district tuition, again because we were able to do the hard work, our teachers, Mrs. Wilson and her staff, to keep the students in district. We did not have to spend as much that we had budgeted for. So as we developed our budget, the priorities that we used, the first three are the first three goals out of the five goals, which are your teaching and learning goal, the professional capacity goal, and addressing the social, emotional, academic needs of the students. In addition to that, we wanted to make sure that we maintained our class sizes in grade K to 2 to that recommended range of 18 to 22. We wanted to preserve the middle school model. We wanted to continue to implement our behavioral health initiatives. We wanted to make sure our school facilities were clean, and we wanted to make sure our technology infrastructure was maintained. Those are the priorities that we put in place when we were developing this budget, knowing that we were going to have to make some reductions. The big drivers for this budget are all of your contractual salary and benefit obligations, both for the collective bargaining agreements and for non-union salary and benefit. It should be noted, and I know the committee knows this, but just for the community, that non-union staff do not have steps, they do not have columns. The only adjustment that they get in their salary each year is a cost of living adjustment. And then also we are anticipating some increases in special education transportation as well as our regular day transportation. Both contracts are up this year. We're anticipating about a 5% increase. And also the budget driver is for any special education tuition increases.
John. What? Maybe Carolyn, because why are we anticipating a 5% increase in transportation?
I was going to say, I know on the regular ed side, we're in the fifth year. We've exercised year options for year four and year five, so we're in the fifth year, so it's advantageous pricing to us right now. So going out to bid, it's fairly cautious to say 5% because they haven't really seen great increases. I know on the regular ed side, we only have two buses in district, so it's not a very attractive or lucrative contract. So the past few years, we've only had one bidder. I know on the collaborative side, they've used the same company for a number of years, and I think they're in the same situation there where it's the end of a five-year contract.
Right. Carol and I are both on the negotiating committee for the SEAM bus contract. And what we found is a couple of things. One is that, first, because we use SEAM, there are 10 other communities that use SEAM as well for their bus, and we're getting the best cost for these different rides because they use multiple routes to put students in. But the other thing we learned during the negotiations is that there aren't a lot of bus companies out there that have the capacity to do what we're asking them to do. That's the first piece. But the second piece in, I believe there's a new law that's kicking in for health insurance benefits for the employees of companies like the bus companies, which is causing the increase. It's a health care increase.
And also the paid sick time.
And the paid sick time.
Right,
those are two things that I guess are now mandated by law.
Mm-hmm. Voted them in.
And that's what's driving the 5% increase.
So who's negotiating that, the collaborative for us? I mean,
we've
already telegraphed to them that we're going to accept a 5% increase if we're built.
No, they're currently negotiating it right now.
Okay.
We We had to make some additions to the FY17 budget. So one of the things that we talked about last year is that in order to get to the reduction number from last year, the $850,000, we reduced the per pupil building funding by, I believe, $100,000 last year. The purpose of that, in all of the cuts we made last year, was to stay away from eliminating personnel. We said at the time that it was only, we could only do that for 1 year because we were on an 18-month purchasing cycle. We do a lot of the purchasing for materials and supplies at the building level at the end of a fiscal year in preparation for the next fiscal year. So we could do that for 1 year, but we would have to put it back in the following budget year. So we're restoring the in FY17, the per pupil building funding back to the FY15 levels. Just so you know, the per pupil is the amount of money that the building principal has to purchase all the materials, supplies, to run the building. Includes the consumables, the curriculum material, library books, the lease of the copying machine, all of those things, as well as some local building PD, some technology, things like that. We are adding a 0.5 FTE at Barrows. If you remember, Barrows had a bubble coming through in kindergarten this year. This is the first year. Next year, they have 3.5 classes right now. Next year, those students will be in 4 classrooms. So we need to increase the current 0.5 position that's in kindergarten to a 1.0 position as those students move to first grade. So that is in addition to the FY17 budget. Last year, we cut regular education paraeducator hours. We are restoring back some of those. We are putting back in to the elementary schools a 17.5 hour per week per school position. What we are finding is that with the busyness of each of the offices at our 5 elementary schools, you absolutely need to have 2 people in there at least at some point during the day. So it was becoming a safety issue that we did not have 2 people in the office at each of the 5 elementary schools. So we had to add that back into the budget from last year. And the last one is a 1 FTE, a social worker for the Killam Student Support Program. Killam, as you know, is one of our bigger elementary schools. It houses our student support program at the elementary level. The school psychologist at Killam has the caseload for the entire Killam school plus this program. So this is we're starting to happen is we're starting to lose students out of that program to out of district because we don't have the services necessary to support those kids. This is the only SSP program in the district that doesn't have its own dedicated support person. So we feel it's necessary to add this in this budget. So we're going to now break it down by the different areas of the budget so that you can see how does this $40 million break out. So the first one is under salary and other compensation. You can see that this area is an increase of about $750,000. This is really all of your contractual increases, as I mentioned earlier, but you also see in this number a reduction of the teaching staff that I'm going of the reductions that we need to make to get to that cut amount that I was mentioning to you earlier. We also have the additional social worker in this area also. It should also be noted that one of the cuts we made last year we did not restore, and that was the substitute teacher budget. We're finding so far that our numbers are showing that the reductions that we made are holding out. We did put some things into place to make it more efficient in the use of our substitute staff when we do use substitute teachers, and that so far seems to be working. So we are not proposing to increase that at this time. Yes.
Just a quick one. Are these numbers inclusive of the 0.5 Barrows position?
Yes.
Okay. Thanks.
Contract services is another area that's a part of the budget. You can see this is a really small increase of about $5,500. We do have increases in for labor council. We are going to be entering a negotiation year. We're entering the third and final year of our 3-year collective bargaining agreements, and we usually do increase on these years our labor council line item. We are also going out for a new cleaning contract, and also we have regular rate transportation as well, as we mentioned earlier. We do have reductions in this area to curriculum services for special ed and special ed professional development. So that's why you see the small increase. Material supplies and equipment is the third area. We see an increase of $248,000. This is really two major areas. One is we're restoring the per pupil that I just mentioned. And also the $150,000 for the new science curriculum is in this area. Under other expenses, we're seeing a slight increase of $6,600. We have some increases for professional development from contracted services, and some network hardware increases that we need to make. Some of our network hardware is starting to reach the end of its life. We also made some reductions to software licensing and parent transportation reimbursement, and that's special education. Special education tuition and transportation is another category. We're seeing an increase of about $165,000. This is for the normal contractual increases that we see for out-of-district placement, and as well as we've identified some students that potentially could be going out of district, so these are anticipated, and transportation increases. Also in this budget is the reduction. One of the reductions that we made was one of the anticipated special education out-of-district tuitions. Grant and revenue offsets, there is a decrease in this area of $193,000. So I want to spend a couple of minutes talking about this and why did it go down when we had a lot of discussions in the fall about taking a look at our offsets and finding out, you know, can we increase them? So as you know, we did... Martha and Sharon did a thorough analysis of our four biggest revolving accounts. And the areas that we can increase, we did increase. And you'll see this in a little bit. But there were some areas that we could not increase. And one of them was the special education tuition one. Remember last year we spiked up the offset for special education tuition because our circuit breaker went down. And we said we really could only do that for 1 year before we depleted that revolving account. Our special education circuit breaker is gone back up again this year. So it allowed us to reduce that amount by about
$300,000.
So what did it go up? I haven't seen.
So our circuit breaker number for this year went up about $60,000, I think, year over year.
What's percent? Why is that, like 60%? Reimbursement or?
Oh, we get reimbursed 75%.
We've been getting, the last few years we've been getting reimbursed 75%.
Once we exceed the threshold.
Right.
So we, and Sharon and I had presented that over the summer. So the special ed tuition revolving account had grown because we hadn't drawn down on it. So in this current fiscal year, we're correcting that. And it helped mitigate the loss of circuit breaker. Mm-hmm. That was not sustainable over time, and we knew it. So we FY17 budget is back to the sustainable about $200,000 a year, which is about what we're taking in tuition revenue for students coming to us from other districts.
And you do see a little bit later on a slight increase in that from the sustainable amount that we. We also made some increases in offsets and fees to, offsets to athletics and extracurricular, and that is based on the fee increase from last year. And we did also increase some revenue offsets for RISE, full day kindergarten, and extended day. And I'll go into more detail on those later.
So that refers to increase in offsets for FY17. The fees were increased
in
this year.
Yeah.
You got to make that clear, because if people read that and say the fees are going up again this year.
But they're not.
Okay, I know. We want to make sure of that.
Right.
People
fees are not, fees
real...
are not going up.
Well,
this year.
But Elaine, to Elaine's point, it says increase in offsets
and
right.
fees.
Yeah.
And even I read it, I'm like, I saw something I didn't recall.
No, we are not increasing.
Okay, so we got to...
So we'll make that change.
Clean that up, because
sorry.
So when you take a look at the budget by cost center, the administration cost center is going up 4.1%, and you'll see as we go into the detail that the biggest driver of that is the increase in the legal piece of the budget, because that's under the administration cost center. There is some other slight increase, but that's the biggest increase. Regular day budget, you see, is only a 1.9% increase, because the majority of the reductions are out of the regular day. Special education is increasing 7.7%, and that's your tuition increases, transportation increases. The school facilities budget is actually decreasing, and we'll get into that in more detail later. And your district-wide programs are only going up 1.6%. And that's how you get to the 3.5% increase. So in terms of the reductions, I'm going to spend a little bit of time talking about these reductions. So the first reduction is two elementary teachers. And where this is going to be is we're going to take a look in grades. This is in grades 3 through 5. Essentially, this is going to affect 6 classrooms in grades 3 through 5, a total of 6 classrooms. And we're looking at right now that the class sizes in those will be no higher than 24-25 when this reduction is made. Should also note that we do have a couple of retirements at the elementary level this year, so the two teachers that would be reduced at the elementary level will have the opportunity to go into those positions of the retirees. The 3.4 high school teachers is a few areas, so I'm gonna break this down for you. 2.0 of the 3.4 is the elimination of the freshman advisory class that all freshmen take in their ninth grade year. Currently, freshmen take an elective every other day for one semester called advisory. It's a class that was put in several years ago, originally to help students transition from 8th to 9th grade. As programs have developed and research has become more available, what we're finding, and I know Mr. Barker can also speak to this if we want, advisory really should be in every grade and should focus on the topics that are pertinent to that grade. So as a freshman, it's transitioning to high school. As a sophomore, you'd be focusing on study habits and study skills, things like that. As a junior, you start your preparation for college and career, those areas. And in most schools that have advisory programs and strong advisory programs, that would be the focus. But we feel that this reduction... none of the reductions we want to make tonight are reductions that where we feel are going to be in the best interest of kids. However, all of the reductions that we have made, we hope what we're trying to do here is have the least impact on the whole student population. So we feel that this advisory reduction is a reduction that we feel we can make and come back to you at a later date to put in an advisory program that would be more effective in all grades, not just at the freshman level.
So with the two elementary teachers, we know the impact. We know that it's going to make grades 3 through 5 go up to 24, 25 students. So what's the impact of losing the two advisory?
So it's the elimination of the advisory program.
No, I know.
So students will not be taking.
What's the impact? What kind of fallout are we going to see from that?
So, students have certain graduation requirements they need to make throughout their 4 years.
Mm-hmm.
And so what this does, it does give them the opportunity to take those graduation requirement courses earlier. So now it does free up. In your freshman course schedule is pretty packed because you have in it several courses. You don't get a lot of opportunity to take electives in your freshman year. So what this does is it now allows you to take some of those art, business, other classes that perhaps you couldn't take till your junior or senior year. So it does give you those opportunities. In terms of reduction of staff, it is the equivalent of reducing 2 FTE of staff. But because advisory is taught in every department, there will be pieces of FTEs that will be reduced across departments. What we are going to be looking at, and this we have to wait to see how the course selection process works, is there are going to be, you know, we're going to be basing our FTE reductions based on course selection and, you know, the number of students that sign up for courses.
Yes.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. So I just want to say that there's one of the themes that concerns me about doing this is that, and I understand, you know, part of it was maybe when we did this, we needed to sort of take another look at it and say how do we need to implement it to be more effective, and it would require more resources. So one of the reasons that, you know, we can make this cut is in part because maybe this isn't the most effective way. Perhaps there are other more effective ways and they require more resources. Well, we did the same thing, it was the same logic, the same, I think, methodology of logic with the middle school health, because we had some resources in place. They weren't really as effective as they needed to be because we couldn't really put in the program. It's the same logic that we've used with the darn science curriculum year over year over year over year. So, you know, it concerns me. And I know one of the pieces while we're on the high school is, you know, the Latin. And you,
I haven't gotten to that
I
yet.
Know. Okay. We haven't.
I actually had a question on the advisory too.
Okay. Well, I just want to say that I think that if we are truly able to capture teaching some of the skill issues, that the skills as part of other classes, I think that it's great because I think having the schedule opening is good because I think the students are strapped. Students who want to have some goals set about what they want to do in their high school career and want to focus on things don't have enough room in their schedule to focus on it. So that could be a good aspect of freeing up that period. But I think that there you have to really look at what was the, you know, are we really still giving students the opportunity to learn those skills of, you know, being organized, being efficient in the other classes? And maybe we are, but we need to make sure of that we're not just doing that for the honors kids, that we're doing that for all the students across the curriculum. So, you know, that's the concern I have about this particular issue, this cut.
Yeah, I just want to reemphasize that the reductions that we are making are not reductions that we feel we're not supporting these reductions. But what we're saying is that we have to make these reductions. And we've been making reductions for 4 years now, which you know.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, we're now at a point where we're making reductions that affect program, that affect classes, that affect people. And kids.
Right.
Two things. When I was asking about this, the reduction of advisory, I was worried about where these students would go, like I think your question was directed to. And the answer that I got, please correct me if I'm wrong, is that they're actually, because the students were so busy freshman year, there is actually space in the electives and more. So it's not that the class sizes are going to be overwhelmed in the electives because there are more students. There'll be more students that can take advantage of it and still have a reasonable sized elective class. Is that the correct understanding?
This gives freshmen the opportunity to start taking their art, music, business and technology,
Engineering, double standard.
And engineering classes.
But there is room in those classes.
Yes.
They are not oversubscribed already. It's not like they're going to be students 25 to 20 to 30 in those classes. They'll still have the smaller group of like-interested students working with a teacher. So that segues it to the other point that was making me feel better about this cut, although I don't like it, is that the other goal of the advisory was to have a small group of students with one teacher that got to know each other better. So it was our connection goal. And so I guess I feel a little bit better knowing that these kids are going to be able to take classes that they're really interested in and connect with a teacher who's very enthusiastic about that elective and work with other students who are also invested in that discipline, that elective. So it's a compromise, but it's, if we have to make this cut, I feel like they'll be engaged with a small group of students.
Yeah.
With a teacher around something they're interested in.
I don't want to speak for Mr. Parker, but I don't want to sit here either and guarantee the kids are going to be in classes of 15 in an art class. I don't think we can promise that.
Yeah, one of the impacts of the advisory was definitely pulling some of the kids out of those early electives, as Dr. Doherty said. So we project, you can't be sure until the schedule is run and course selection happens, but it's a fair assumption because the numbers did dip when advisory was introduced. And as far as the advisory piece goes, in talking to students and teachers, I think the impact that we had hoped with the skills, although it was a solid curriculum, may have not paid off the dividends to remove sections from each of the departments that are staffed in the advisory. But we are working with union leadership to take a look at a model that would be far less frequent, with some concessions around evaluation and other things, to staff a 9 through 12 model. And offer that informal relationship with an adult, more of a social emotional support over the 4 years versus just freshman year.
And that answer makes me feel better, because while I like the idea that the freshmen now have the open part of their schedule to take their electives, we're still taking something away from them by not offering advisory anymore. So if we're looking for ways to still get the good parts of that program available, that's a good thing. Yes?
I think it's a great thing, too. It sounds good. But if we can't fund freshman advisory, what's the reality of bringing it in 9 through 12? I mean, that's going to cost more money. So it sounds nice, but that isn't something that's in our very near future.
This particular model would not be sections within a teacher's contract. There would be an added fund other than possibly training. This would be coming from a different school system and negotiating and working with the union leadership. It would be every 9 days, every 10 days, a 20 to 30 minute non-teaching period where materials are provided. So the preparation that typically goes into a classroom, like advisory way it's currently constituted, would be far less rigorous, demanding, would be done by administration, and the impact would be a little bit more general, mm-hmm. more social emotional support versus some of the study skills and really that academic curriculum, but would still provide a lot of the benefits of just those informal relationships with an adult besides a guidance counselor that advisory really strives for in a lot of districts.
Thank you.
So continuing on the list. So the next reduction out of the high school piece is we have 2.0 currently Latin teachers, and we're going to be reducing that by one. So there'll be a reduction in the Latin program. Essentially, it's from 10 sections to 5 sections of Latin. Again, it's not a reduction that we want to make, but really it basically is another area that where the course enrollment may not be as high as some of the other areas, and so this is an area that we're going to be taking a look at. Mr. Barker is going to take a look at what sections will be offered in Latin with this reduction, and that's something that we haven't quite yet determined yet.
Ms. Webb, did you have?
Yeah, I just, this is sort of the more bigger picture theme, and that's that people might be able to sit here and say, okay, so it's Latin. You know, a lot of us might not think that that's that important. Some people may think it's very important, but I think the thing we have to remember here in Reading, we're not even talking about the Chinese or the Mandarin. And we stopped talking about that, I think, far too long ago, because there's no way that we can talk about that now. But yet, that's something that as our students are, you know, doing their college applications and their interviews and looking at things, you know, there are students coming from districts around here that have had those opportunities. So I look at that and I say people may think that's not such a big deal, but I think it's a really big deal because we've stopped looking where we should really be. And so that frustrates me. That cut frustrates me more than it might seem on the surface of it, because I'm really making a little bit bigger connection to it. So I hope that in truth there will be the opportunity for students to get into sections of other things that interest them. But I know that you did something really creative to get an extra section of engineering. And if I remember correctly about that, there's probably like no way we could get that creative, you know, this coming year. And especially, I think, given what we're talking about, we probably lose that opportunity. So while we, you know, might want to hope that there's going to be enough resource to provide the programs and the sections, I think we're at risk for in areas that we're not really, that we wouldn't touch upon otherwise in terms of the direct subject matter. But thanks, Chuck.
And then the remaining point four of the 3.4 is we're going to be and that actually ties in a little bit to the next reduction. We're going to be reducing a department head at the high school. So we're going to be eliminating the department head for phys ed and wellness. That's the smallest of all of the departments at the high school. The assistant principal for athletics and extracurricular activities will now supervise that department. So from a supervisory standpoint, it will be supervised by one of our administrators. The reduction is twofold. It's the stipend piece, but it's also the course sections that person would have been teaching if they were full-time. So department heads have a 0.6 teaching responsibility. 0.4 of their day is for their department head responsibilities. And so you don't lose sections of teaching, but you do gain that salary reduction. So the salary reduction is the stipend plus the cost of a 0.4 teacher. The other part of the high school stipend is a leadership position here at the high school as well. So, which is about a $3,000 stipend. So those are the high school reductions between the department head and the 3.4 high school teachers. The next reduction is a middle school, 0.5 middle school teacher. This is a reading specialist position. We currently have a total of 2.5 reading specialists at the middle school. And so this is going to reduce it by 0.5 so that there will be one reading specialist at both middle schools. We actually have a very strong literacy program at the middle school. Our sixth graders all have double literacy blocks every single day. So there is a lot of support in our middle school for literacy. The services will still be available for those students that are struggling in reading and require those reading services. This is not necessarily a special education issue, so I just want to make sure you understand that. This is for students that are not special education that would be requiring reading services. The next reduction out of regular day is a high school regular education paraeducator. This position is basically it's a library paraeducator. So this person spends their time in the library. The impact of this reduction is going to affect sometimes that the library may be open to students. Most of the time we're talking about is after school. The hours are set up so that the person starts later in the school day and then is here later so that the library is open later here at the high school. But that is not, with this reduction, that will not be happening. I will say that we do have support at our middle school level for the library staying after school, which our PTOs fund. So we do not have any other funding in the district that pays for after school library supervision, and our PTOs have stepped forward at the middle school to provide this. So I think it is something that Mr. Barker may be having a conversation with the PTO to see if this is something that they can fund. And then in special education, the last personnel reduction is a 0.4 speech and language pathologist. This really came about a few years ago as we were making the transition from Barrows to Birch Meadow in the DLC program. It required us to have additional speech and language services. We're actually in the last year of that transition. So all of the DLC program will now be at Birch Meadow next year. So this should not result in a decrease of speech and language services with this reduction. Had some conversations with Mrs. Wilson on this, and we feel that we can make this reduction. So those are all the personnel reductions. The non-personnel reductions, there are two. One is an anticipated out-of-district placement with transportation. I showed you a slide earlier that shows that we have turned some funds back the last couple of years to the general fund at the end of the year. Most of that has been out of special education. So when we develop the FY17 budget, we take a look at students that potentially may be in out-of-district placement. And we felt that we could reduce this by one. We've had some pretty good success over the last few years developing programs and strategies to keep students in district. So we feel that we can make this reduction of this one. It is a little risky, but I think it's one we feel we can make. And then we then went through all of the cost centers and made minor reductions throughout the five cost centers in a variety of areas, $1,000 here, $5,000 there, throughout the budget to get that last $32,000. Again, with the idea that we were trying to stay away from more personnel reductions. We then looked at our revolving accounts, and I already talked a little bit about this, and how we could maximize the revolving accounts that we felt we could maximize. So the first one is the extended day. This was one that we had lots of discussions about earlier in the year. And what we are doing with here is, since extended day is in our buildings 4 hours a day, and our custodial staff cleans after the extended day programs have left, we feel that, and we did look into this, and it is perfectly appropriate, that we are going to be charging 1 hour per day, per school day, per elementary school of custodial cleaning to that budget. So that's a $90,000 increase in offset that will be going into the school facilities. And again, that $90,000 means that's less of a personnel cut. We felt, because we are still seeing an increase in students in full-day kindergarten, that we could increase the offset by an additional $30,000, which would mean that this year $900,000 would be taken out of full-day kindergarten as an offset. Special education tuition at $15,000 is from the sustainable amount that we were talking about earlier. We do have potentially a student coming in from another community that we feel that we could make that increase. And the athletics and the extracurricular, is based on our fact that last year we did increase the fees. We are not increasing the fees this year, but we feel that we can take a little bit more out of those two areas because we did increase the fees last year. So those are the budget reductions and offset increases to get to the number that we had to reduce.
Can I ask two quick questions?
Sure.
On the revolving accounts, I know Martha did a tremendous amount of work with Sharon. When will she, have you worked with her on these reductions, or is that something that will happen after it goes to FinCom? In terms of her understanding how we're changing the revolving accounts, have you discussed that with her yet, or will that happen after it goes to FinCom?
No, well, for the extended day, Sharon and I had a thoughtful conversation about what was appropriate in terms of offsetting the budget with custodial support, and we usually came to that number through conversation. Through the kindergarten one, the analysis that we did over the summer, we know that second half of the day is costing the district about $960,000. We couldn't exceed that in terms of our revenue offset. And a certain number of students, it really is incumbent upon the operating budget to pay for that second half of the day because they're here. They're at that because of an IEP or low income, and we've waived tuition and that sort of thing. So to go from 870 to 900,000, we felt like we could do that, and the revolving fund could absorb it. So those are really the only two increases. The athletic and extracurricular, really those were things that Dr. Doherty and I looked at to try and minimize personnel reductions. The athletic one, this year, the revolving fund will pay 100% of the coaches. So that the offset is equivalent to what we're paying for stipends for coaches in the budget, and similar on the extracurricular.
Thank you. And if I can ask one more follow-up, and it's about the Latin. You mentioned that the enrollments were lower in Latin than, say, in other languages. So that potential personnel cut doesn't necessarily mean that half the kids who want Latin will get it. I mean, some children won't, but it won't be 50%. Is that right?
That's correct. And that's something that we're going to have to take a look. You know, we don't have specific details on what that would look like
yet.
A lot of it's going to depend on, you know, the course selections.
Okay. Thank you.
John? Yes.
I have a question about the science curriculum. So does the 150, is that just curriculum? Does it include any of the coaching to implement the curriculum?
No, it does not include any of the coaching.
So it doesn't include any coaching. And do you anticipate is that the amount, same amount that you would need in years 2 and 3, or?
That's what we're anticipating right now, but, you know, we certainly want to see how things go. The plan, and I can let Craig talk more about this, so we started piloting some things this year. With the No Atom.
Mm-hmm.
The plan is to phase this in over 3 years. We would do 3 grades at the elementary and grade 6 in year 1, the other 3 grades of the elementary in grade 7 in year 2, and then grade 8 in the high school in year 3. I mean, certainly that can change too, but that's what we're...
Then obviously part of that is that the largest expense is the first year, because you're buying the initial materials, the durables that are sustainable. So that's the larger expense. We then need to be sure that we are absorbing in the budget any year-to-year cost.
The consumable part.
I mean, science by its very nature has a little higher amount of consumables. And that's also why it makes sense that the building per pupil is restored, because that's going to have to sustain then that expenditure year to year for the consumables for science. I mean, any good curriculum that really is aligned to the new standards and so forth is going to have a certain amount of consumable expense year to year.
Will our professional development budget be able to handle the support that the teachers are going to need to utilize this new curriculum?
I mean, that's something that we're still looking at. I mean, ideally, you know, we would love to have additional coaching and so forth. One of the things that we normally do when we contract with the vendor for new materials is some amount of professional development that's part of that, and how to implement a new program. And so that's something that we're still looking at. It also somewhat depends on what direction we go in terms of what curriculum we choose.
Is John, the 150,000, is that the plan, I don't know if you've discussed it with the town manager, whether that's gonna be the plan every year to take it out of the numbers and.
I did discuss with the town manager that I was gonna be recommending.
As a one-time issue.
I was gonna be recommending an additional $150,000. I think it depends what's gonna happen in future years with the budget.
Okay.
If we are looking at an override in FY18, it could be something that you roll into that as part of the override. Those are discussions that would have to be made as part of it.
Okay, yes.
I have two questions on the science curriculum. The frameworks are scheduled to be signed off on this month.
This month, yeah.
And the level of confidence that these are the new frameworks?
Yeah, they've been in discussion for 2 to 3 years now.
I think so. I mean, if there's little tweaks, right, we're expecting that they're gonna be pretty much what's.
Yeah.
I feel like since I've been on the committee, it's been like they're gonna be signing these curriculum frameworks like any day now.
I think it's pretty sure now.
Okay, good. My second question was having piloted No Atom but not committed to it yet as a curriculum, how confident are you in that $450,000 total cost? If you don't know the curriculum you're buying, how do you cost it out, is my question.
I mean, we use that as the basis for our projections.
Okay.
I figured that was probably in the ballpark or probably even on the higher end.
I thought it was. Okay.
Yeah.
Good. Thank you.
Okay. Let me continue. Okay. So when you break this down by cost center, the FY17 budget, you could see the bulk of the highest percentage is regular day, followed by special education, then followed by district-wide programs, facilities, and administration. Notice facilities is much lower now because of the transfer
to the core.
And when you look over time, our budget has stayed pretty steady in each cost center. You see this year the regular day, which is the tallest blue, is lower because of the reductions in that budget. The majority of the reductions are in regular day. But over time, administration has stayed around it looks like 2.4, which when you look at other districts is one of the lowest in the area. And school, pretty much all of the other ones have stayed pretty much the same. You break it, when you take a look at the dollar bill, district administration is the smallest, followed by your largest group is instructional services, 80.1. And then other school services, which is anything that isn't directly involved with the classroom, is 5.5. Operation and maintenance, 4.2. And then payments to other districts is 7.7%. So again, most of the budget is focused on instructional services. And then when you look at it by category, you see the biggest increase is supplies and materials. And again, that is because of the $150,000 for science curriculum and for the per pupil, restoring the per pupil to FY15 levels. So what this budget is not able to address is the long-term improvements. And I'm going to show you two slides that really focus on the conversations and the data from this spring and this fall. But a lot of the things this budget isn't able to address are the things that would continue to move our district forward, provide more opportunities for our students, restructuring the elementary and the high school schedules, and space. So the next two slides show you the identified needs, and I think this is probably these are the things that we really feel we need. These aren't pie in the sky requests. These are the things that we feel we really need to improve our schools. We've also tied it into the goals. We have the five goals, and those are on the right. So things like the instructional coach for science, completing the science curriculum implementation, upgrading and improving our student information management system. This includes a communication piece with Edline. Right now, our student information management system is more on the antiquated side, and so this is an area that we feel we need to upgrade. Teachers at the high school to change the graduation requirements, restructure the schedule. Staffing for the elementary to provide additional course offerings and electives. Health education at the elementary level, health education at the middle school, adjustment counselors at the elementary and middle school. These are all things that are needs and we've have discussed several times over the last couple of years. Tier two academic social emotional support helps students that are struggling academically. We don't have a lot of tier two support in our school district. We either have supports for everybody or we have tier three supports. Additional special education staff and clerical staff to support our special education staff, because right now, and we saw this in the exit survey information, a lot of our teachers leave that are special education teachers because of their caseload and the paperwork load that goes with it. And they spend a lot of time doing the paperwork and not have enough time working with kids. Instructional technology specialists at the elementary level. We only currently have one for five schools. A district-wide technology leadership position. And a sustainable funding cycle for technology maintenance and replenishment. Right now we have $100,000 in the budget for this year. Some years we've had that, other years we've had to cut that in half. Ideally you need about $250,000 to have a five-year cycle to replace your technology on a regular basis. If you want to just hit no, that's great, thank you. The total cost of that is about $2 million. I should also add that there are two other things that are not in this number. The first one is if we ever went to tuition-free full-day kindergarten, you'd probably add about another $1 million to that number. And then the other piece is, and we've talked about this several times, I know the town is struggling with this as well, is retaining and attracting staff. That number is not captured in here at all as well. And, you know, I've said this before to the school committee, is that, you know, this year we had situations where we've had five teachers, last year we had five teachers leave the district to go to other districts in this area for better wages and benefits. We also offered positions to four teachers this summer that denied, and they went to other districts, again, for higher wages and benefits. These are the types of things that are starting to hurt us. And these are the things that we're going to have to look at in future budgets. And I know that I think on the 20th, this is going to be part of our discussion. So that's the overview.
To that point, do you have a feel for what you feel that number would be across the district to be able to adjust wages that you feel are?
I would want to do a better analysis. I mean, we have comparable salary scales, which would be very helpful. So I would have to, I don't want to just.
Yeah, we don't want to have that.
Yeah.
Yes.
Well, I think there's you know, there's some other areas that we haven't looked at also when we just talk about sort of we've done a great job with the ALICE implementation in our school security.
Yep.
But I think when you look at some of the types of security features at other high school campuses or college, especially college campuses as our students go off to college, I think there's some things that we need to be looking at as a community, not just for our schools, but, and I think that's where I don't believe they're anywhere in this funding. So
it's not in the funding, but I will tell you that we have started having those conversations. Town and schools have started having that conversation.
So we're just doing the administration cost center tonight?
In regular day.
Yeah.
So do you want me to continue or?
Is there any other comments or questions?
I had one question, but it goes back quite a few slides, Dr. Doherty.
Sure.
Under the accommodated cost, there was a big drop in capital this year.
Yep.
Could you explain that drop? I'm sorry, I didn't ask.
Town manager can explain that.
I have a guess. I don't know if I'm right.
Little out in November.
Like, yes.
The original capital number would have been a lot smaller. And then some Novembers, we've done a significant amount, $700,000 or $800,000. you remember last November, I forget the number, we did the Josh Wheaton roof for something like 800,000. So starting place to starting place, the capital probably went up a little, but based on what we actually did mid-year, you know, it's gone down a lot.
Yes.
Did you have?
Nope, I'm done, thank you.
I guess, I just, going back to the budget priorities and the budget drivers, and you know, looking at those, I just don't think that we, maybe, I'm not sure that we've really captured the needs of our high school, and we may say that, you know, budget priorities, maintaining our technology infrastructure, and but I think you've just, you know, we've just gone over some things where we're not funding some things, and they particularly impact the high school. So I just have a concern that as we look, you know, we've looked at these priorities and how the priorities and the drivers play out into the things that are funded or trying to select the cuts, I'm just not sure. And over the course of the year, you know, we've talked a lot about what's going on at Joshua Eaton and the task force. We've talked about you know, the science, some of the issues that we've had with the science performance in at one of our middle schools, and you know, we're trying to say that we're going to need to focus on that. And I think there's some data that was presented. I'm glad to see what the administration and guidance are doing, looking at some of the data for our high school. But I think that some of that data tells us we need to be taking a little bit more aggressive action. And there's nothing in this budget that's going to do that. And so that's another year that we don't make enough progress. So I know we're going to go through the details. I'm not confident. I'm going to find something to be able to tell you, we'll substitute, you know, cut something else and put something else back. But I'm just overall really concerned about it. And I think we have got a nice high school profile that's sort of the culmination. One of our principals of the high school, during the first part of the construction, he always said, make sure you emphasize, do the things you need to do at the elementary school and the middle school level, because we absolutely have to get that right, and I'll figure it out here at the high school. But we can't keep, you know, we definitely can't, we're not in a position to do that. So I'm concerned. Probably Adam's concerned too, but.
I think we're all concerned about the reductions. I don't think any of us is saying, oh, these are,
well,
these are
I
things that we want to see happen.
Right. I guess I see, maybe I see things, and we're going to go through the details over the next couple of days, and maybe it'll flesh out a little better for me. But I just see that maybe the high school is, there's things that we really need to do, and this is not going to get there, and the cuts are, you know, maybe impacting it a little more, not necessarily in the, like the actual cut, but the fact that year over year we haven't done certain things. The Edline stuff, you know, we've been maybe needing to invest another 20,000 into that for like 4 years. So to not have that 25,000 again this year, you know, it doesn't look like much, but we've been trying to put it in for a while.
Did you have some?
I did. You mentioned way at the beginning of your presentation that last year we made significant changes to substitutes and reduced that line item when we were maintaining that reduction. How's that going a year into that? How is that? Is it the current level of funding for substitute teachers adequate?
At this time it is.
Yes.
We've been monitoring it on a monthly basis. At this point in the year, we're okay.
So that was a good restructuring last year.
It appears so. I mean, it was tough to do based on the data, the limited data that we had from the increase to go. We went from 65 and 75 to 75 and 95 for licensed versus non-licensed, and we increased our from $100 to $125 for our long-term subs. But part of that was we had a couple of years where we had teachers who were out for extended periods that were being covered by long-term subs, and so it's a trade-off. So far this year, we're doing okay, but if we had other teachers, you know, another year, it might not be okay. So to answer your question right now for this year, it's going okay.
Yes.
To that point, though, I think I've heard that the ability of the teachers to take professional development has been decreased because the substitute budget to replace those, not the teachers, but the ones that want to go out and take a class, that has been reduced because of
the success. We did. That was one of the restructuring efforts that we did this year, that we wanted to focus our PD more in-house. That was one of the trade-offs when we had to reduce the budget.
You answered my question. I had another thought. I was kind of like, how did we, yeah, you answered it.
Thank you.
Okay. So this actually may go by a little bit quicker because we did a lot of the detail in the overview. The questions that you asked, so this may not go by as slow as that. So the first one is the administration cost center. Here are the functions of that cost center. It is the smallest cost center out of the five. The school committee, the superintendent, central office, which includes your assistant superintendent, business and finance, you can see there. District-wide data and information management and legal services are under this cost function. Here are the different initiatives. Again, they're all tied into the five goals that we talked about earlier. The staffing pretty much has remained unchanged over the last several fiscal years. We have 4.8 administrative assistants, in which 2.5 are focused more in the finance and operations side. 0.5 is the HR piece, and then I think 0.5 is for the assistant superintendent. And then 4.3 district administrators. We have the superintendent, the assistant superintendent, director of finance and operations, the HR administrator, and 0.3 of our network manager. The network manager's salary is spread out over two cost centers because of the different functions that person has. You could see here by object, the big increase is the 18%, and that is your legal budget. That's where you see the biggest increase. The salary increases, especially in the clerical, you're seeing you have a turnover in some of the staff, and we had the transition with the turnover, which is contributing to the increase. When you look at it by function,
Go ahead.
Okay. When you look at it by function, each of these functions is the position plus the support services that go along with that function. So with the school committee, it's the services that are used to support the school committee, which include, I believe the dues are in there, mm-hmm. the MASC, and some other support services. With the superintendent, it's the administrative support, professional development, materials and supplies, all of those things. Same with the assistant superintendent. All of the different function areas, it's the position plus all of the support services that go with it that lead to the cost. And again, legal services, you can see, is the biggest increase. So here are the budget drivers. The COLA salary adjustment is 2.5%. All of the non-union, we budgeted 2.5% in all of our cost centers for non-union, which is comparable to the collective bargaining agreements. well, we did see a slight increase in salary due to staff turnover with the administrative assistants. The legal services, which I already talked about, because we're entering the collective bargaining agreement negotiations next year. And we did restore a little bit of professional development, and we increased our software licensing with in the HR piece to implement position tracking. It's a much more effective way to keep position control and the positions that are out there, what are available and what are not.
It's in Munis.
It's actually with SchoolSpring, but we're also going to do
position
control in Munis that
Munis.
The two are in sync.
Oh, okay.
It's a goal of HR in mind for next year.
So that was
Gina.
I had a question on PD.
Yep.
Earlier, it was, I thought in the special education area, we were reducing special education.
It was a move.
Okay.
So the PD money in SPED has remained flat year over year. It's level funded. It was in contracted services. It's just moved to other expenses.
Okay.
So it's the same dollar amount, but it was a decreased driver on one, on contracted services, and an increased driver on another.
Okay.
So it's this level funding.
Thank you.
And for PD here, this is PD to support the administrative staff. So it's the HR administrator being able to take a course, or John, or any one of us. So it's nominal money.
Any other questions on administration? No? Regular day, we did go in a lot of detail with regular day already, but do it again. Major cost center functions with regular day. Basically anything that relates to teaching and learning in our school buildings that's not IEP driven or special education driven falls under regular day. So this includes all your school building leadership, your school secretaries, all the supplies and materials that are in the school, all of your instructional services, which include teachers, specialists, your regular education paraeducators, substitutes, all of your teacher leader mentors, PD stipends. Guidance and counseling is under regular day, not under special ed. Sometimes people are confused that why isn't it under special ed, but all of your counseling and psychological services is a regular day expense, not a special ed expense. All of our instructional materials, which includes the per pupil increase and the science equipment, science curriculum, and regular day transportation, all under regular day. You can see that when we look at the goals, the majority of the initiatives that are going on under our five goals are regular day based, which is what they should be, because we should be focusing on the classroom and the supports with that. The budget drivers is our contractual COLA increases for the three collective bargaining units that are under regular day, also our non-union COLA increases. And then the increases, which I talked about earlier, the offset of $30,000, the 0.5 grade one teacher at Barrows, the contractual increase in transportation, we restored the per pupil expenditure funds, the paraeducator support, and the science curriculum are all in here. The reductions, of course, is the staff reductions. And then here's the breakdown in the staffing, and the reductions that I talked about earlier are captured here. Here's the reduction for the elementary. It's a 1.5 reduction because of the 0.5 increase at Barrows. You see the high school reduction captured there. And I think the rest of them are
just set these.
Right. And by cost center, again, the supplies and materials is the largest increase, and that's due to the per pupil going up and the science equipment, science curriculum. The other salaries are contractual increases, and the professional salaries is a result of the lowest increase because of the reductions. And by function, the highest percentage of this cost center is instructional services, which again makes the most sense since that's the bulk of your expenses and salary is in that area with teachers. And then by function, you can see the increases that go along. All of this will be also, just so you know, in the budget book that we hope to get out to you by midweek. We're putting the finishing touches on it right now. But all these charts that you're seeing here will be in there as well.
Yes.
I have one. Dr. Doherty, if you could go back just a couple slides to the regular
sure.
day cost center by object.
Yep.
The supplies and materials line item jumped out at me. The requested budget for FY17 is $832,000. Even if you back out $150,000, that's $682,000. That's a substantial percentage increase over the last 3 years. Clearly, it's lower than in FY13, which seems to be an anomaly. That's a huge
So I'm just wondering.
FY13 was the math curriculum increase.
Okay, so yeah, it kind of jumps out as we did something that year.
Yeah,
the
it was
same
the
way
math.
The science curriculum will jump out, but I'm still having trouble squaring 650, 597, 579 to 682.
You had the per pupil increase too. We've restored the per pupil back to FY15 levels.
So the FY16 budget is reduced for taking the per pupil away, and it's restored in FY17.
So we should really be looking at the 650 from FY14. That's a more normalized figure.
Yes.
Even the 597 is more normalized.
Thank you. That's what I thought. If 650 is more normalized than 597,
oh, I know the other increase.
I'm looking at 682 and thinking that's a
the other increase is we restored the 50,000 back in instructional technology.
Yes.
That's where your other, that's where the other number is.
Can you explain that a little bit,
so
instructional technology?
Last year we cut 50,000 out of instructional technology. We had tried to maintain 100,000 for replenishment. Last year we cut it by 50. This year we restored it back.
Okay.
So that's the other increase, the other big increase.
So you have the 50 of instructional technology, the 150 of the curriculum.
The curriculum and the restoring of the per pupil.
How much was the per pupil amount again? Dollar amount for the district.
The restoration of it came to just under 100,000. It the dollar amount varies by grade level. So at the elementary level, I believe it's $140 per pupil. The middle school level, I think it's the same, and at the high school level, it's a little bit higher.
It's a little bit higher.
So depending upon enrollment, it varies year to year.
So I was thinking it was like, for some reason, I had like 30,000 a building in my head.
No, it depends on the building because it's by student, the number of students in the building.
So if I take out that additional 50 for instruction, that brings it to 632, which is closer to the 650 number. And can I ask one follow-up?
Yeah.
Can you explain what additional instructional technology needs are? Why did that cut last year to 50 not work? What did we not fulfill that we need to fulfill this year?
We're not replacing computers. When our computers last 3 to 5 years.
I was thinking, okay. I was thinking different. You mean literally hardware?
Oh, yeah.
Oh,
yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Gotcha. Thank you.
But didn't we have an agreement with the town manager that we were going to add that into capital?
No, we didn't.
I thought we
what
said for the replenishment site.
No, it's not a capital expense because it's less than 10 years.
No, I understand it doesn't fit the normal definition of capital, but we were going to add, I thought it was 150 a year or something.
He's been talking about adding it to accommodated costs.
We've had conversations that we really should be treating technology like an accommodated cost because it really is like a utility.
Right.
But that has not happened.
But didn't we do that like 2 years ago?
No.
We absolutely added something.
That was for infrastructure hardware,
yes.
Not for computers.
Infrastructure meaning like the wireless, our network.
Yeah, wireless network,
yeah, cabling,
your servers, things like that.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. It was, like John said, it was for infrastructure, not for.
Because that has a longer shelf life.
Was that town and schools we did that?
It
was just the schools?
It has alternated in the past, but I think that's going to be stabilized in the future.
Mm-hmm. Did you have a...
Did I answer?
You did.
Okay.
Thank you.
And I already went over the reduction piece, so I believe that's it for regular day.
Other questions? Yeah.
I guess I just want to make sure that as part of the overall process, I think you gave us sort of a report last year. I'm not sure what the timing was actually on the Friends of donations. I just want to make sure that I know what that scope is.
That will be in the budget book, right?
Will it?
I think so. Mm.
You're talking about for the coaching assistants and other athletic.
Martha prepared it.
Yep.
Yeah, actually, it's not. We can add it to the budget book. It was part of the user fee overview that I did when we talked about donations and the volume and the scope and what they were, the directed donations, what they were for. So it was part of a presentation that I did.
It was. I know it was separate.
Fees.
Okay.
So I just want to, I mean, I'm just talking as we go through this, I don't even mean this month, but as we go through this process between now and before we vote, we would vote, I just would like to see that updated for what we have so far, you know, what we have available. Mm-hmm. I realize not everything might not be in for this year, for sure, right?
Correct.
I just want to make sure I understand. You say you want, what, since July 1?
Yes, although I think we probably, from whenever it was done last year, we probably didn't have the completion till June 30th. So there's probably some data that from
we
wherever.
We did it last year. We did it last November. It was before we started the budget process because the school committee was voting on the fees.
Fees, right, right. So I guess I'd like to see that data filled out. So for the
so in addition to the revolving fund information, you'd like to see information on our donation accounts.
We accept the donations every meeting. Now part of our consent agenda. We hear a lot from the community. You know, one of the things that does get the most attention and did last year too was we raised the athletic fees, and then there's some people who don't realize that happened until they pay an athletic fee for the first time this year. And I just want to make sure that that I understand, you know, what those numbers are. There's a lot of you know, each of the teams does fundraising. They pay for a variety of different kinds of things. Some of it's, you know, different sort of consumables for the team. Some of it's banquets. Some of it's coaches. There's a whole lot.
At the State of the Schools in November, I did get that number from Arthur. It was $160,000 last year.
Oh,
that was all donations.
All donations.
Yep.
For athletic.
No, that was, yeah, that was any donation that the school committee approved last year was $160,000.
Oh, any just random donations.
Yep.
Ref, everything.
So do we keep, but I think what you're asking, do we keep an account or a books on what the groups actually, because they don't always come back in the form of donations. They will spend that for their operation of the team.
Right, right.
We don't know. Do we know what that is? So it would be like, I don't know, say the wrestling club has their own set of books that they raise money for certain things, and they aren't all donations to us. They're things that they spend for their program. Do
Correct.
We keep track
and
of that too?
No, we do not. I mean, they're an independent, separately formatted.
I was asking just for the donations. I just really wanted to see sort of a accounting, you know, the data on the donation. So, I mean, if it was 160, that could be broken out then.
So what the school committee accepted for athletic donations last year from the different parent groups?
Yeah, to your, it's really, I said athletic, but it's really the athletic and extracurricular. It's
right.
All those donations that we accept. I guess not that I'm not interested in, I know we've received some great other donations. I'm thinking the
all the REF Foundation donations.
Right, REF, Rotary, the women's, there's a,
yep.
Why can't I think
yep.
of the club?
Yep.
Right, there's
160
a whole bunch.
was everything.
Everything,
I mean, the
right.
money that we raised through all of it's right outside there where people can donate clothing, articles of clothing.
Oh,
some
right.
Money thank
right.
you. Textiles. I mean, anything that we took in as a donation went into that 160,000.
Oh, so I'd like to just see that sort of broken out in a way to,
sure.
And know where we are. So it ended at 160 last year was the total. But
for the fiscal year, yes.
Yeah, I think, you know, you did something for us last year, whether it needs to be as detailed as that or exactly the same. I just think it's important because people, that becomes part of the dialogue during the budget. You know, not only are we cutting, but then people are aware of what their contributions are.
That's only a portion of it because, you know, if a kid makes a team now, that's, you're writing a check almost immediately for something that's not provided by, that we can't provide
right.
So, or selling something to raise that money. So, and that doesn't always come back for
right,
coaches.
Right.
I could add on
yep.
to that. The PTOs at each school aren't reflected in any of this, and the PTOs raise a significant amount of money that support what's going on in each individual school. So the
other than what specific donations for programs, because that's a piece of
a
it.
A lot of the PTO money
yes.
is just funneled right into
right,
the school, and we never see it. So I mean, it really is. It's probably
right. I mean,
not
I don't think we can.
It's hundreds of thousands of additional revenue that's coming directly from parents.
Right.
I don't think we can ask Martha to keep track. I mean, but the stuff that comes to us for acceptance.
I was making the broader philosophical point, not asking you to account for it.
Thank you. Duly noted.
Yes.
It'd be nice to get the float on it, though.
Oh, yeah.
I just wanted the opportunity to sort of my own reflection on how difficult this process is. It kind of echoes what Dr. Doherty said at the beginning about the term recommended in the loosest sense. And especially after consecutive years of doing this, that when the administrative team goes through this process, I mean, it's a really exhaustive, thorough process, but it's also can be rather agonizing in being able to determine what can we do. And then I always have such mixed emotions on nights like this, because we're pretty much explaining the rationale for something that's been chosen. And it can, you know, when we have questions and conversations about why that's chosen, and it can sound as if it's like why we can feel good about that particular cut, but that's not it. It's the rationale, which is sort of like why we determined it might have a somewhat smaller impact than most of the other options that we looked at. But it's not something that we can feel good about, and it's probably not the direction that as a school district we want to be going. So that's just the weird emotions that we have during this, that those are really, really hard decisions, because first half of that list clearly all have an impact, but they were chosen by the administrative team as probably having some of the smaller impact than many of the others, which is still nothing to feel good about,
right.
Especially when it's consecutive years of doing this. So that's hard. It's very hard.
Yes.
There was sort of something in line with that I didn't make a report on, but there was a event over the weekend that was a reunion of the Coolidge Science team in honor of a teacher, 28 years, John McCarthy had been here, or more?
Was it 20 years.
That John McCarthy was in the district, and he coached the science team. And a couple of things I just really wanted to highlight, and they really impact here. There was a woman who had been on the science team in 1992, which was the first year. And she started out by saying, I was in the first year. The only year that we didn't weren't the state champion. And then she went on to talk about what it meant to her, what that teacher meant to her, that she didn't really have a place. She was sort of this awkward, tall, skinny, nerdy kid, and that provided an opportunity for her to really blossom and gain confidence and grow. And there were a lot of people who were very teary talking at that event. And just how thankful she was that the district provided that and recognized that, you know, for her, that opportunity really helped her grow. And there's you don't really know where that's going to be for any given child. That's why we have to offer such a rich variety of things. But she also had said she lives in Pennsylvania. Somebody sent her the article that was in the Globe last week. And she noted, as she spoke, she actually noted, I don't understand, you know, I read this, how could Reading be in the bottom? Like, well, they don't lose sight of how good this district is. She hasn't been here in quite a while, but she just was really struck by that. And I think, but really, you know, emphasizing how important it is to continue to be a leader. And she was, you know, really, you know, hopeful that we would, you know, figure out some ways to keep stepping forward and not fall behind. But it was overall that event. I don't how many people there were over about 150 people.
There was over 150 people there.
All ages, all parents and students, and it was such an honor for John McCarthy, and some of his family members were there, and had the opportunity to hear people talk about how this man influenced and shaped their lives, and made them who they are today, and. I think maybe teachers don't get to hear enough of that from their students. Obviously someone passing puts you in that place of reflection. But, I think teachers can have a really big impact, but we need to take care of the teachers. And we need to be able to do the things that are going to make them excel along with our students. And I feel like 13 years ago, we were in a really bad place in this community, and we said we never were going to be there again. And I'm not so sure that we listened enough to ourselves. So that, I thank you, John, for organizing that, and the staff at Coolidge for organizing that event and that tribute. And it was a wonderful day. So.
Thanks. Anything else? Yes.
Shall I do that with the school committee?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Move to adjourn.
Second.
Second.
Thank you.